Thanks for checking out the podcast. This episode, we talk to Andrew Bennison from Prospect Games in the UK. We talk about their new game, Unbox, which is available on Steam. We talk about game development, getting into the games industry, a bunch of really awesome things, some of the challenges that come with working in the games industry as an indie game developer. Thanks for checking out, guys. Let's get straight into it with the trailer of their new game, Unbox. Welcome everybody to a podcast today. With me we have Andrew Bennison, who is the managing director of Prospect Games in the UK. They've just released one of their first games on Steam, or the first game on Steam, called Unbox, and it's a really awesome 3D platformer. And so I got him on here to talk about game development, game design, how they went from where they started, and where they're going, and things like that. So welcome, Andrew.
Thank you for having me.
No worries.
This beautiful Wednesday morning. I don't even know what day it is anymore.
Yeah, well, I suppose it's 7:30 in Australia on Wednesday night, and 10:30 on Wednesday for you guys. Is that right?
Yeah.
So you guys just released a game.
We did. We just released a game a week and 2 days ago onto Steam. Unbox. Buy it now.
It's been quite exciting.
It's been because we kind of in a weird way went through this with Greenlight. Greenlight kind of felt like launching your game in a sort of prototype fashion onto Steam, and that was like nerve-wracking. That was a really intense experience, and this was like 100 times more than that. And it's still ongoing. Like, I think a lot of people think when you release a game, it's like you press go and it's out and people buy it, and it's like, woo, you know, I'm done. And it's like launching a game's really a thing that starts months before you launch and continues for months afterwards. Like, we've really realized that there's going to be a lot of work between now and really Christmas for us to keep pushing the product and keep creating content for it, keeping people updated, and just keeping people aware that we exist. I mean, a thing that we've heard a lot of people say is like, wow, I love Unbox, but I haven't heard of it until the day I saw it on Steam. And, you know, that is an exposure issue that we've been facing for quite a while, and most indie developers do face it just because there's so much competition. So it's in a weird way becoming easier now that the product's out there and is getting older and more people are saying positive things about it. It's becoming easier to sell it because we've got a larger repository of other people saying, like, yeah, it's worth a purchase.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. I didn't see it until I saw your post on Indie Game Developers Forum. And I was like, how did I miss this? Because like, I've been like looking for games like this for a long time. It's a really awesome concept. So I want to get into some of the design aspects of Unbox and things like that. But I think first, it'd be interesting to learn a little bit about where you came from, why you guys decided to start a studio, things like that. So I thought I'd ask, first of all, where did your passion for games come from? Like, what were your childhood favorites, if you were to give like some favorites?
Well, I mean, I started with like Missile Command and Asteroid on the Game Boy when I was like age 3 or 4. So my passions really laid a lot in like N64 and Nintendo type games, which you can sort of now see has accumulated into Unbox. But between then and now, I really got heavily into Xbox and then online gaming when Xbox Live first launched. So I was really into things like Project Gotham Racing, massively into Halo. And it was actually Halo that kind of got me into wanting to make games, because I started making Machinima back when it was called Machinima. I started making little movies in game engines, and that got me more interested in the games design side of things. And then I joined up at a university course that studied taught games design at Salford University, and that's where I met the other guys who found Prospect with me. And kind of all of us had different tales. All of us, I think, Jack had come from more of a PC gaming background, Tim had come from more of a PlayStation background, so sort of all the main sort of categories coalesced with us, and we made loads of cool prototypes and games in university. And once we left there, we'd gone out into the industry and kind of felt like it would be good to go back to those days when we were just making the games we wanted to make from the experiences we had as kids.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, that sounds really cool. So you worked in the industry for a little while, did you, before you branched off and did your own thing?
I personally did mostly like freelance work at companies like Dubbit, and I tried to busy myself as much as possible with Tim doing Left 4 Dead modding. And we actually, Unbox is technically Prospect's second product. We launched a mobile game called Bypass on Android and iOS in 2013. So we were basically in the evenings after our normal workday jobs, like just tinkering away at this stuff. Jackie went to Codemasters straight after uni, so he worked on Dirt 3, Dirt Showdown, and Grid 2. And the other members of Prospect, we hadn't basically met at that point, but they were all basically in the industry in various areas as well.
Awesome. So your role is primarily the managing director of the, you're basically the dude, right, of Prospect. You're the head honcho kind of thing. Is that right?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, just about. I hope I am. Yeah. yeah. So yeah, and all of us have multiple roles. Like I'm the MD, but I also take a sort of creative director role. But I've also done writing on the game, a lot of testing, and it's the same. Everyone on this team is actually like 5 to 10 other people, because when you're a small team, you've got more work to do. Basically, you can't spread it out too much.
Yeah, exactly. So when did you decide to go to, you said you did a design course, you went to university or some sort of design school. What made you choose to do that? Was that fresh out of school that you did that, or did you like go into the workforce or anything like that beforehand? Or
it was really actually a sort of last ditch effort to send my life in some kind of a meaningful direction. I flunked it at A-levels, and up till that point I wanted to do games journalism. I was getting really interested in games journalism and games writing. But because I was also doing these movies, I was also getting interested in making games and getting into the games design side of things. And it was basically just dumb luck that I came across this course. I looked at a few others in the region, they were all crap, because this was 2007, so you know, the indie thing hadn't really happened. Xbox 360 was only just out, like it was a completely different world. And all these courses were awful. So I found Salford Uni's course by accident. And just basically signed up because I don't know what it's like in Australia, but in this country there's a lot of heavy pressure to go into higher education, especially if you've already been through, you know, through GCSEs and through A-levels. It's kind of like, well, you got to get out there and go to uni. So I didn't even comprehend the idea that I could have just started working on games at that point. And in retrospect, I wonder if we should. And I usually recommend to people these days, unless you find a really good course, which is still hard to come by, you know, all this software engines and stuff are free. Just start making stuff yourself. You'll learn much faster than some guy who's 5 years behind the tech, who's probably never worked in the industry, trying to tell you how to make games. It's like, no, just learn it yourself. But I'm glad that I did go, because it's where I met the team that we've basically been able to found the company with. So
yeah, that's really awesome. So do you want to lead us through starting a game company? Like, how does that happen? You mentioned that you went from bedrooms to kitchens to office spaces to publishers to indie. Can you lead us through a little bit of just starting a company and what that entails in regards to, yeah, how do you do that? What are you doing? What are the steps you guys took?
Sure. Well, I mean, for Prospect, we basically just started. We started Prospect in my living room. I was on a laptop and just went onto the company's house, registered Prospect Games for £100. And it existed. That's the very first point. The rest of actually building up was a much bigger set of work. So it came down to us, we were doing modding in Left 4 Dead for a while. And we wanted to make this app. We wanted to get into mobile gaming. So we decided to actually turn Prospect Games from just sort of a modding group into a company.
Yeah.
And get some people together. Once we had the app out, which we basically just did you know, it effectively cost us nothing. We did it in a couple of months. We did it in our spare time. It was just a chance to see, could we put together a product start to finish and in some way generate some cash from it? And, it was a success in that regard. It was after that point that it was like, okay, we're getting older, because by that point we were sort of like 23, 24. And while that doesn't sound old, to us it did. Like, to us it felt like, okay, we're getting on, you know, by the time we're 30, we're going to have mortgages and families and all that kind of stuff. These things can take years to build up. We should really start this now, because we were out of uni for a few years by this point, and we didn't really feel like our lives had moved forwards, and like we'd really put into practice those skills that we'd learned. So we started saving up money. We went round friends and family to try raise cash. And in the summer of 2014, we moved into a flat in Eccles, just around the corner from this office. And we started developing stuff out of our living room. Now, on the side, I'd tried to set up another company called Update Events, and we were making doing gaming events in Manchester and the Northwest, both expo-type things where we have loads of game devs and people coming in and playing their games and giving them feedback and having a fun time. We also were doing nights where we were doing dev talks, people doing presentations, showing off their games, networking, and we got hundreds of people involved in this, and it kind of like jump-started my ability to network with people in the industry, because all of a sudden lots of people had heard about me and my events. So from there, we were able to connect with more people and bring them on board as staff. Chris and Sam, who sit there and behind me, they're not in yet, I don't know where they are, but they're going to be, they joined up with us, and from there it kind of snowballed, where we were with that size of a team, with five of us, we were able to start putting together interesting prototypes, start taking those to events, and it was a game jam in the Christmas of 2014, UE4 game jam, where the theme was What's in the Box, is where Unbox came from, and we scrapped everything we were doing up until that point, because we were like, wow, Unbox is actually, this is a really fun idea and people seem to like it, let's develop this into something. And it was at that point where we were able to borrow a lot more cash. We had to do all of this project on an extreme shoestring budget. We've had to like hustle a lot. We've managed to get really good deals, like this office is insanely cheap for what we get. So we've been extremely lucky to have just the right people and the right resources and the right events and everything fall into place at the right time to get us to this point. If I had any advice to give to people, it's don't take as many risks as we did. Do things a bit smaller, because it's dumb luck that we were able to get to this point. A lot of hard work, but if those points hadn't happened when they had, we wouldn't be here.
Oh wow, that's very interesting advice. That's really good there. I like that. So you started small with Bypass, is that right? Which is your Android game?
Android and iOS. I don't know if it's still in the iStore. We don't really support it anymore, but it's out there somewhere.
I couldn't find it on the Apple's App Store. Maybe I just couldn't search for it, but I did see some stuff for it on the Android store. It looked pretty interesting. Looked pretty cool. It looked very similar to. I always tell people when starting a game design to start small, and I think that's what you guys did there. Like, it looked like you guys were like, "All right, let's just release a game. Very simple concept. Let's release something, and see if we can do it." And it's really cool that you guys did it that way.
But then we took this quantum leap to Unbox.
Yeah, I was about to say that you went from Bypass, which seems to be a really simple kind of just a mobile game, to all of a sudden it's like, oh wow, this looks like it's done by a serious studio. How did you do that? How did you manage to go from one extreme to the other, really?
Yeah, and the advice I'd give is take a few steps between those two points, unless you want extreme grey hair forming on your head or just all of it falling out. But it was really the people. It was just we were lucky enough to get the people that sit around me here on board at the right time. And I think a lot of it comes down to your passion and drive. Like, there's a lot of studios and games that are made by good people that end up as not very good games. And I think the fact that we've got a very open team that talks a lot about ideas, and we're very open about feedback, and we were doing non-stop QA testing, so if something didn't work, we didn't do it or we changed it. I think the biggest example of that is the single player up until August of last year was completely different. So it was more like Trials HD assault courses. So it's just get from one end to the other, maybe collect some stuff as you go, but you've got to do it as fast as possible. And it was meant to have ghosts and an online component where you could race against your friend's ghosts. But it just sucked. Like, it didn't work for whatever reason. We just didn't have the right kind of design down, and we took it to Minecon, and the kids were loving local multiplayer, playing that for, you know, hours, and then the single player, they were just sort of playing for 30 seconds and giving up on it. So that at that point, I, you know, went away for a while, had this sort of eureka moment of, oh, well, we've been inspired by things like Mario and Banjo, let's make this open world exploration game. And we started it last August, so that pretty much half of the game was done in 12 months, and that was a gargantuan task for this team to carry out. And, you know, for all my drive and everything and beating of the drum of, oh, let's do this, if these guys hadn't followed through and understood the vision that I had with that open world single player, it would have never have happened. And communication is exactly the reason why that was able to take place, because we talk about everything.
Yeah, that's awesome. That actually leads me to, it sounds like you guys have a really good culture in your office where you're open to talk about the good, the bad, and the ugly. What is the culture around there? It seems like it's pretty cool culture in that office.
Yeah, it's I don't know how to describe it. It's extremely open. It's very no holds barred, and I think it comes from the fact that you know, the founders of Prospect as friends, you know, we just act like friends pretty much, and we've certainly become more professional over time, and we'll continue to do so as we grow. But we come from a point where if we don't like something, we say it, and yes, we don't hold it back, and we usually include an insult along with that, but in a friendly sort of jovial manner. There's a lot of joking. But I think it's kind of needed. Like, the way I see it is, if you're going to be this creative entity that does weird stuff like games about sentient cardboard boxes, and, you know, there's a whole heap of story and narrative in Unbox, and it's very weird. Like, people who have commented on it are going, like, this is some weird stuff. And it's like, yeah, it is weird, and that comes from the fact that we're also a weird bunch of people that have weird conversations, and I don't think you can make something as nuts as Unbox if your team as well isn't open to discussing and talking about absolutely anything and everything.
Yeah, that's awesome. I've had the same thing with I compete in Ludum Dare sometimes, and I find that I never try and make a funny game. I always try and make a really serious game, but it always ends up just being this hilarious, stupid game. And I blame Conker's Bad Fur Day and yep, all the games that kind of and you know, Banjo and that quirky, rare kind of early Nintendo 64 kind of stuff that just real funny and just lighthearted fun, you know. I'll blame that.
Well, and they were the best kind of game. Like, those are games. Like, there are plenty of games that do very, you know, narrative driven stuff. Like, I'm a massive fan of Dear Esther, and there's lots of games that take themselves maybe a bit too seriously for their subject matter, and that's all well and good, but it's like, I really like fun games that don't take themselves seriously. That's what we really like to make here. And I think there is, in a weird way, a lack of that in the industry today. There's this big desire to have meaning and story and narrative and all this kind of, and representation of ideals in games. And it's like, fair enough, that, you know, there's room for that, but there's also room for having, like, games are games. They should be fun and wacky at times. So that really drove us with Unbox, because we played loads of those things as kids, and it just seems like there's been a lack of that for quite a while. And when those things do come about, people judge them and go, oh, this should have this and that, and it's like, eh, let people do what they want.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's really cool, because we I've personally been craving that. They're the kind of games I love, like Unbox. You're in a bright, happy kind of, you know, it's a nice place to play. That's one thing I'll say with, like, Unbox is you don't feel moody, or you're just having a good time collecting stuff, jumping on stuff, blowing stuff up, but it's all fun. Just, it's not
and hopefully getting weirded out by the story as well. Like, we want people to be like, this is strange.
Yeah, it is. That's definitely the vibe I've got. I'll play the intro now about 5 times, because every time I recorded it, something slipped up. But so I know the intro very well, and I've done a lot on the Paradise Island, and it's awesome. Really love it. Cool. So did you have, after the prototype, did you just make the choice to, you're like, well, this game is working well, let's get some investors, or let's throw some of our own money in there, let's get personal loans. Did you guys, how did you guys make that step from just, okay, we're in our garage now, to let's take this seriously, let's make this our full-time jobs?
Well, yeah, so when we started Unbox, we figured, like, this is, we'd spent about 6 months prototyping other things up to that point, and we were like, right, we need to make something, we need to get it out there, we need to make money, we've got to make a thing. Now, we originally estimated Unbox would be sort of 6 to 12 months. Shortly after starting, it was like, right, this is at least going to be 12 months. Turned out to be 21 months, so that's another bit of advice, is whatever your estimates is, always double them, and yeah, then try see what you, how you can shave them down. But we recognized very early on that we were going to need more money. So my family is quite entrepreneurial, and after a lot of convincing, I was able to get them to put some cash in. Since then, we've done a lot of talking to investors, both individuals and entities, publishers. We went everywhere to find cash, and we're in a pretty good spot right now where we've got a few really good leads, and the fact that we now have a game out there with like actual metrics like sales data, YouTube coverage, really positive reviews, not just on Steam but from publications, and I know that more are coming, because as I said, the launch is something that takes weeks, and especially for indie games as well, it's like you don't get day one coverage, you might get like day 55 coverage, and it feels out of place, but it just takes place over a longer time span. So we're now in a position where it's like, okay, we're making some cash, we got people interested putting cash into the company, that's great. But to get to the stage, like I said, was incredibly risky, and we worked on an extreme shoestring budget. The entire team has been working for far less. I mean, any of us could be making so much more money, not just elsewhere in this industry. We all have transferable skills we could take to completely different industries, you know, management or design, art, whatever, and be making absolutely way more than we are right here. So there's a lot of passion that's got into this, and an understanding that we've had to take substantial risks to get to a point where, yeah, we've got a game with sales data and we might be able to make now a lot more money. And that would let us do much bigger things.
Yeah, that's always the goal, isn't it? To have enough money to be able to work on the games you want to work on.
Yes.
It's very interesting that you say that. Like, have you seen the movie Indie Game, the movie?
Yeah, quite a few times now.
Yeah,
that for us was kind of a sort of like a bit of a wake-up call as well, because we watched it a few years after, because Meat Boy was like 2010, and I think it was 2009, 2010, and you know, by the time we watched it was like 2013. It's like, oh god, you know, like that's what we want to be doing, and these guys were doing it years ago, and they've inspired tens of thousands of other people to do it. Like, we've really got to get our asses in gear.
Yeah, you wouldn't believe, I'm at uni, and you wouldn't believe how many people cite Indie Game the Movie as the deciding thing that made them pursue games. So it's an amazing film. I've watched it too many times as well. But it's funny, because on that, it seems very much like you put your game out there and you just watch the millions flow in. And it seems to be an industry where you either make millions or you make pennies, or you grind until you know what I mean? You either have a Galaxy Cube like me that doesn't make any money, or you have Clash of Clans, or you grind and you make enough money to keep your studio alive. And
even with those guys who make all that money, there's still so much grind. Like the guys who are doing Shovel Knight, you know, they've been hammering out content, like really high quality content. So they got the Plague Knight expansion, and they're doing Spirit Knight, and that's like, even though they've got all that money, and this is another thing, even when games shift a load of units, when you actually break it down, like, I can't talk too much about specific sales data with Unbox just because of various things, but you would be amazed, after tax and after everyone else takes their cut, how little a company ends up with, that even when you've shifted millions of units, you know, you're not, money runs out really quick, and even if you make a couple of million, it's like, right, a couple of million will sustain a company of 20, 30 people for a year or two, maybe. So even if you make millions, it's like, right, what are you going to do? Cut and run and, you know, retire with your 2 million in the bank? Or are you going to reinvest that into the next thing? Because if you do, and you make a bigger project with, you know, more office space and higher tax rates and all that, it runs out just as fast. It's kind of like RPGs. Like, every time you level up, all the enemies level up. It's just as hard every single stage, if not harder, because now you're dealing with everyone's expectations. Everyone expects you to succeed, so you can't make something worse than you did last time. You've got exponentially more things to manage. You've got more people to manage. You've got, now got to market and advertise more. You've got more things to do. You know, if anything, it gets harder. And I did a talk on this last year about like the realities of starting a business. And through my research, it turns out about 90 to 95% of companies don't live past 5 years. And anecdotally, looking at the indie world and the game dev world in general, absolutely the case. Like we've done EGX now for, we're doing EGX next in about a week and a half, and we've done it last year and the year before we were attendees. And basically nobody who was there 2 years ago is there now. And if you go back through, none of those guys have a second game out. Like the amount of indie devs who one ship a title on Steam and make cash is pretty small. And then those who actually go forward to make a next their next game, a second title, and then release that and have success with it, like it's infinitesimal. It's like 2%, not even actually make it to that stage. And you know, we're only just at the point where we've released our first title. Like I can't 100% say we'll ever release another one. We're certainly working towards it, but the odds are stacked against you at every step of the way, especially when you are an independent that doesn't have many industry contacts, that, you know, you're fighting against this massive increase in content going out there into the world, not just from other indie titles, but, you know, you're dealing with bus adverts of Call of Duty every day, distracting people from your little product. So, yeah, it's monumentally difficult to do this. And I think, again, advice I'd give is if you're looking to get into starting your own business and running it, is you have to be prepared for some serious grafting that will last for years. And just like we've really been humbled by making Unbox over the past 21 months about just how difficult it's been. I've gained a tremendous amount of respect for people who have come before us and released titles, because to do what we've been through and then carry on going is, you know, it's mind-boggling. Most people could not handle this. They just couldn't. And it's really given us a respect for how long you've got to graft on this stuff for. You know, we're not millionaires yet, and we're not going to be millionaires for a very long time. It's going to take a lot of work for us to get to that stage. And even at that point, we're going to want to put all that money back into the company. So yeah, you've got to be ready for long-term graft, I guess, is what I'd say.
Yeah. One of the things I find interesting is Meat Boy was released in 2010. And then after that, Edmund made Binding of Isaac, which was just a three-month quick little game he made. And Fez came out, but Fez 2 got cancelled, as you know, and then Jonathan Blow went on to create The Witness. But out of all those guys, it seems like I have a lot of I have heaps of respect for all those guys, but it seems like it's almost like it'd be hard, if I was in their position, I think it would be hard to then jump into the next, like to finish another game, because of they know what the, like, it's emotionally draining, do you know what I mean? Like, if it cut out all the stress and stuff, just emotionally, just investing so much of yourself into something for so long, and that grind would be so emotionally draining, I can only imagine. Would you agree with something like, with that statement there? Like, the just the emotional side of releasing a game?
Oh, yeah, absolutely, and it's a double-edged sword, because when you're doing this, when you start your own business and you're making a product and it is your product and you're the thing driving it, like if it wasn't for you, it wouldn't exist. And the second you stop, it stops. You have to put a certain amount of you into that product. And so your self-worth, your health, everything is tied into how well that product's doing. If a product's doing bad, you start to do bad. But you need to do that to keep the thing moving. And then on the flip side, you can't do it too much, because if the game doesn't go the way you want it, or somebody says a nasty thing about it, or says something about you, it affects you that much more than if you were just working on something. If you were part of a bigger company and, you know, if somebody slags you off, it's like, eh. This affects you, I think, a hell of a lot more, just because you're really super invested in it. Like, your life is riding on this product. And so I've tried to keep myself at a distance, keep myself in an emotional balance, like, while at the same time driving the product. But you can't get too heavily invested in it, and you can't base your self-worth too much on the quality of your work. Like, it's a really weird, I've not really quite figured out how to do it, but I've tried to, you know, when we have negative things said about us in reviews and that kind of stuff, try to explain to the team, like, you know, it's normal. You know, people are going to have differing opinions. Sometimes they're going to be written poorly. Sometimes they're going to be written right. In all cases, there's something to learn from them. And, you know, and we're, at the end of the day, our biggest critics. Like, we've slated various aspects of Unbox. There's so many things that we would be much happier with if we'd had a few months to work on it. But it's just a case of, it's always like that with any product. Yeah. And we're trying to take all those lessons we've learned, and it's like, right, the next thing we do, whatever it is going to be so much better at a baseline just because of everything that we've been through on this.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
So that's the positive I tried to take away. And I think that's what the guys like Blow have done with The Witness, is, you know, take all the good. I know he struggled particularly with the bad, as did Phil Fish, but, you know, both of them have moved on. I know Polytronic's doing a new game. Obviously, The Witness was a success. Binding of Isaac was a gigantic success, and they've moved on to that, what was it, Game 8 or something. I think it has a name now. But yeah, like they've clearly been able to figure out how to invest everything about them that makes their games their games. You know, like Meat Boy, Binding of Isaac, like those feel like they were made by those guys. No one can take that away from them. Mm. They've been able to do that while also not getting crushed by the constant pressure, weight, and criticism that would be just layered upon them.
Yeah, it must be an art form. I had like 10 of my friends rate my game 5 stars on the Google Play Store, and then there was just one other person who wasn't a friend who rated it, and it was a 13-year-old girl. 1 star and just said bad, and I still remember that it cut so deep. I was like, oh, like I felt it in my chest, like it is bad, I know it's bad, but don't tell me it's bad, like so I'll quickly touch on that. How do you deal with negative feedback with your content? Do you just try and shut it out of your head, or how do you approach negative feedback?
Really in two ways. I think there's always some truth in negative feedback, even if it's just someone telling you to F off. Like, there's something there. Like, there's a reason that person's saying that. And that's down to how you've approached them, or how the game operates, or your marketing. So even the most negative of things, there's some truth in there that you can extrapolate. Not all the time, but there's something there. And you shouldn't, like I said, you've got to disconnect yourself. You can't let one praise go to your head. Like, just because you get a 9 out of 10 or something doesn't mean you're God's gift. And just because you get a 1 out of 10 doesn't mean you're scum of the earth. You've got to try to disconnect yourself and view it pretty objectively and assess, well, why is this person saying 9 out of 10 and this person saying 1 out of 10? Because somewhere in the middle is probably the truth of the matter. The 9 out of 10 is probably bigging stuff up a bit too much, and the 1 out of 10 is probably exaggerating things too far down. The reality is somewhere in the middle. So I try to do that, and I also try to use negative feedback as a way to improve our relationship with the community and with consumers in general. So when somebody says something negative, you know, I think what guys like Phil Fish did was interesting, in how he was able to generate so much buzz in PR by telling people to, you know, do all sorts. That was really effective in generating publicity, but not very good in creating consumer satisfaction with you as a developer, not just with your product, but with you as a developer. It's hard to enjoy a cute-faced game when you know the developer behind it is spitting fire at the most meager of criticisms. So we try to use that as, if someone's approaching us with a problem, try resolve it. If they're approaching us with a problem and they're being just vicious and mean about it, we'll still try to fix it. We're probably not going to make this person happy, but we can at least show others, hey, we are trying, and if you do come to us maybe a bit politer, we'll try even harder. So it's kind of like when you're debating somebody, you're probably not going to change their opinion, but if there's an audience, you might turn somebody else around out there. And so we try to treat negative feedback the same way, and to be fair, same with positive feedback.
When I'm prototyping a game, I always tell people to tell me one thing they like and one thing they don't like. So, like, they're forced into telling me negative feedback. And if everyone's saying the same thing, like, the controls suck, or I don't like how this looks, then generally I can look at that and go, okay, well, maybe this is something that needs to be changed or looked at. So let's talk about Unbox in a little bit more depth. Where did the idea come from?
So yeah, it came from the Unreal 4 Christmas Game Jam. The theme was What's in the Box? And we spent hours coming up with weird and wacky ideas. And after a few hours of sitting around twiddling our thumbs, just brainstorming, Jack went off and came back a few hours later with this box rolling around that sort of opened up, and a box popped out, and it created these big towers of boxes that you could then sort of like wobble around and throw your box off the top of it. And then we added a little impulse to it, so it popped out, and that was basically that's where it came from. We threw a split screen into it and thought, well, wouldn't it be funny if these boxes like had to race against each other? And that's basically the first iteration of the game, was just straight paths with dynamite and crushers and obstacles and physics-y things that fall over. It was just get from one end and get to the box at the other end. And there was a little warehouse hub level that tied all the levels together, where you could jump in a box and change how you looked and jump out and jump into fire and explode. And it was just messing around in that and putting that demo up and letting other people play it that kind of made us go, and seeing the positive response most of all, people actually doing let's plays of it, putting videos up on YouTube, telling us, oh, this is fun, you should do more of it. That was the point where we were like, right, this is kind of an MVP, like we've hit minimal viable product, people want this, let's do more of it. And you know, we then went all in on the idea of a cardboard box that rolls around. Like, we could have just spent 2-3 months on it, and maybe we should have just made a small thing, but I'm kind of in the long run glad that we did something to this size and scale, because you know, we've had people say like, this looks like it's been made by a massive team. How many people have worked on this? And I say, really, about 6. You know, that's the core team, is 6 people have made this. And they go, wow.
Yeah, I'm generally surprised as well. What do you estimate is the length of the game? I've only got to play about 3 or 4 hours of it. How much more have I got to enjoy?
We've seen quotes, because for us it became really hard to judge, because we could just blast through the game. Since we got it out there, we found a lot of people saying, look, to complete the main quests and get through to the final boss, you're looking at about 6 to 8 hours. If you want to do everything, including collectibles, you're looking closer to like 10 hours. And then, of course, the local multiplayer side of things is technically endless. I mean, I still play Pokemon Stadium pretty regularly. So, you know, by that logic, you've got 20 years of life out of it. Hopefully.
Yeah, I really I haven't had a chance to play multiplayer, but I really like the fact that you guys started with a multiplayer in mind. Or is that correct, that you guys started with multiplayer and you branched from there?
Yeah, so it started as a local multiplayer experience. Then we realized, well, because it's local and there's not online, there's nothing for people to do if they've not got their friends around. So let's give them those obstacle course type levels. It was after that we realized this isn't going to work, plus we could do something more exciting and interesting, and that's where the open world, sort of Super Mario 64, Banjo-Kazooie type gameplay came into play. Which is kind of a weird way around of doing it, that we started with the local multiplayer side and ended with the single player. But I'm really glad that we added it, because it's pretty much nailed the vibe that we wanted to go for, nailed the experience we wanted to go for, at least based on the reviews that we've had.
Yeah, it's awesome. I love the aesthetic. How did you guys land on what it looked like and the quirkiness? Like, it seems to me very inspired from a lot of the rare titles, the early on rare titles, like your Banjo and your Conkers and things like that, where it's a little bit just quirky and fun.
I guess, because a few people have asked us, what is the style of Unbox? I'd say vibrant realism, in that it looks real, but we've kind of cranked all the values and made it, oh, you know, very colourful and a bit quirky, but we've also tried to make things to scale, like the transport plane is based off of schematics of a real plane. Like, we tried to give it a sort of real feeling, but kind of hyper real. It's weird because we started with a really abstract art style. It was meant to be much more like Marble Blast. So it was going to be like disconnected floating platforms and just sort of big skyboxes. And we were going to have little like smatterings of real things throughout it. So for example, if there was a patch of ice, we were going to have like just an open fridge next to the ice with ice sort of spilling out. And it was meant, and just stuff like little quirky like references to reality. So it kind of felt like almost like it was a simulation or like an abstraction from reality, because it was we thought it's a box rolling around, it's an abstract concept, let's put it in an abstract world. But as we started developing more maps, we started settling on this idea of, oh, it'd be fun if it was on these like tropical islands, and it, you know, if you had oil rigs that you could fight on. And so we slowly started going from a sort of somewhat drab minimalist art style to something quite colorful, and that was definitely influenced by the fact that we went to so many events and people were enjoying it, but they were going like, oh, it'd be fun if it was more colorful and vibrant. It reminds me of these games like Mario and Banjo. And we were thinking, right, okay, we probably should adapt the art style, but we couldn't at the end of the day go all in with a super stylized look. Like, ideally, we would have done, like, a sort of cardboard-type world like Tearaway, but at the time of starting, we had one artist, and making bespoke, sort of hand-painted or handcrafted items like that can take an extremely long period of time. So we tried to create an art style that could be very quickly made and outsourced to others if need be, while also capturing that vibrant nature. So it's a bit of a... I'd say we've come with one of the weirdest art styles for a platformer ever, because platformers generally are like quite chunky minimalist designs, or they're abstract. They're not usually realistic as what we've made. And it's certainly made the design harder as well, because, you know, pipes are complex structures, the rock faces are complex structures, and because we got a physics game, those things need to have complex collision. And it's made the performance of the game something that was a real top priority to get it working, because just about everything in Unbox is complex in some fashion.
Exactly. I really, really enjoy the music. It's really, it brings me back to the Nintendo 64 era, I would say. Really enjoy that. Do you have any plans to bring it to the console or Mac or Linux or anything like that? Or is it going to stay on PC? Or do you got any DLC plans or anything like that?
I can say we do have some DLC plans coming coming extremely soon. In terms of other platforms, we've certainly looked into it. We actually kind of jumped the gun and announced Xbox and PlayStation in February of this year because we started working on those builds. I think that was a bit of a... We really did jump the gun on it. We need to develop more to see what we can do on those platforms. You know, a big thing we struggled with was taking a game we'd made for PC where you have quite a variety of rigs and you can... You know, you've obviously got to optimize it extremely well, but we kind of underestimated just how much we'd have to for the consoles because they have their own little quirks. So those things have come along. Right now, we're focusing just on the Steam launch. Like I said, this thing's going to keep going for a few weeks after we launched last week on Steam to try really push the build out there, get people covering it, obviously get people buying it. At that point, we're going to assess what is the most sensible platform to bring it to. At the end of the day, consoles really do make the most sense. Like, this is a console game at heart. It's inspired by console games. We always recommend people playing it with a gamepad, and we always play it with gamepads ourselves. So I really want to get it on more platforms. But there is the harsh reality of financial constraints and whether or not it's actually going to end up being worth it for us as a company. Like, is it going to generate the money we need to keep going and more so to be able to make bigger and better things? So we've basically just got to assess how the next few weeks go. Hopefully good. So far, so good. So.
Yeah. That's good. So has the launch been what you've expected, or how are you going? I suppose, obviously you can't talk about numbers or anything like that, but you could talk, you know, how are you going, you know, how are you sleeping? I'll say it that way. Has it been an exciting time, a nerve-wracking time?
I'd say it's been everything. It's been, you know, dreadful and amazing simultaneously. And as much as you try to keep yourself on balance, it's very easy to get pulled one way or the other, just because this is the culmination of, you know, for me especially, like 3-4 years of trying to get to this point. So it's been very interesting. We didn't really have that many expectations going in for launch, to be honest, because we knew that we were fighting a massive uphill battle. So we had a publisher, and a few months ago we decided to go independent again. And that freed us up in many ways, but also cut some ties off in others. And what that's resulted in is us basically launching the game ourselves and doing the PR and marketing ourselves, doing everything ourselves. And it's been an extreme challenge. So we tried to sort of, I guess, temper our expectations of how sales were going to go and we understood that we're not going to get a load of day one coverage. I think personally we're underneath where I'd like to be, but then that's always going to be the case. Like, I'm a perfectionist. I'm never happy with anything. You know, there's always room for improvement. So looking at it from a more realistic standpoint, we're doing pretty good, all things considered. And the coverage that we've been building up over the past week, and the coverage I know that's coming in the next week, is really going to help us. And that's a massive thing that we've learned, is that sales directly correlate to coverage. You know, being on Steam isn't good enough. No one cares if you're on Steam. You know, that's not an important point anymore. People discover games through their favorite YouTubers, through big websites. If you don't get on those, you don't get sales. And I've seen so many amazing games sell like 500 copies and then just flatline. And we've spent weeks and weeks and weeks contacting people. I've personally contacted about 300-400 people at this point. We've overall contacted probably over 1,000 journalists, YouTubers, whatever it is, you know, podcasts, blogs, vlogs, and everything in between. And then once you do get that coverage, the conversion rate's like 1-2% of a piece of coverage. So, you know, if you get like 20,000 hits on a YouTube vid, you might only be getting like 200 to 2,000 people actually going through and looking at your product. Sales can be much lower than that. There's not a great conversion on this stuff. Even if the person on that channel or on that review is saying, go buy it, like, it's super worth it. It's just the way it is. And I've seen this with enough games and now experienced it with ours that it's like, okay, this is the correlation. So I think this is where most indie devs fall down, is they get to launch, they go, oh, I'm not Phil Fish, I'm not Jonathan Blow, we're not seeing loads of people buy the game. And they basically just give up. I've seen that a lot. And it's like, no. Because in 2, 3, 4, maybe even 10 weeks' time, we might have to wait till Christmas to get big sales in. But they'll be coming, provided we keep working. So for us, I've tried to really focus on the fact that we've had this extremely positive response. Like, people playing the game, to us it feels like we've nailed the mission statement of making this 90s-style experience. People are really enjoying it. They're saying, man, I wish I'd heard about this sooner. I hope more content is made for it. I hope it comes out on PlayStation, etc., etc. So that is the real positive that we're focusing on. And beyond that, it's like, right, we've had a pretty good level of coverage thus far. We've had really nice reviews. And I know that we've got more coming because I'm constantly emailing and tweeting and talking to people. And I know that we can use that data to encourage other people to give us coverage. And we've also got a pretty good game plan for us from now until Christmas to get more content out there and to keep talking. Just giving us excuses to talk about the game, like we'll be at EGX or Play Expo Manchester, etc., etc. It's just keeping a story going about your game, keeping people informed. And I feel like we've got enough going for us that we're going to keep going. That's what I think.
That's awesome. That's really good to hear. I look forward to seeing it on consoles, because I can see it being a really good game to have a few beers with and a couple of friends over to play. Do you guys... So Unbox is like... It's basically the title for your company, isn't it? It's like, hey, we're here. This is what we do. Do you guys have any plans on, like, are you already thinking of Unbox 2? Are you already thinking of DLC? Have you got other future games in mind?
Fucking a list. Unbox 2-y? A list a mile long of ideas. Yeah, we'd love to do more content for Unbox. We'd love to do more Unbox. Got an absolute ton of ideas. And loads of other game ideas as well. What we've tried to do running up to this point is to be as sales driven as possible, so we made the decision to not plan too far ahead, which is something that historically I've always tried to do quite a bit and then always been disappointed in the results, because you can't have stringent plans for months and years ahead of yourself, like, it, because you don't know what's coming next. You don't know if you're going to succeed, fail, if opportunities are going to arise. If we'd stuck to the plans that I had 2 years ago, We'd have made Unboxing the Game Jam and gone, oh, well, it's not part of the plan, so we're not doing it. You know, there has to be, in any form of business, quite a reactive element. You know, make a plan, but try to react when things massively change. If you see an opening, go for it. So, for us, it's a case of, let's just see how Unbox sales go on Steam. let's see what the kind of reaction based on that is for getting onto consoles. And especially, like, what kind of the doors that are already opening for us, the fact that we are one of those few developers who actually made a game, start to finish, released it, got positive reviews, and want to keep doing this. Don't just want to say, right, screw this, I'm not going through that process again. It's like, we're hungry to do that again. That's opening doors for us already that could completely change everything for us. And it's early days, and we got to keep at this every single hour of every single day. But so long as we keep moving forwards, things are going to change for us, and for the most part, for the positive. But it's very, very hard to plan when you've got, you know, 100 doors opening for you, and you can only go through one at a time. So yeah. I can say that, yeah, we want to do more games. I just don't know what that's going to be yet.
Yeah, it's still such early stages, obviously. Do you feel like taking a holiday after crunch?
Yeah, a little bit. I've got a trip down to London for a few days planned next month, and I guess EGX in a weird way is like a really crap holiday in that I'm going to be in a box for 5 days trying to sell my product, but at least I'm not in the office. Yeah. It'd be nice, but at the same time, you know, we've not made enough to have a all inclusive trip to the Caribbean or something. So we're just going to keep working at it. You know, the holidays will come down the line, and I've personally felt like I kind of felt running up to launch that I was running on empty. It kind of felt like there was no fuel left in the tank. What I actually realized is, oh no, I've actually just hit that point where you're realistically like, right, this is my life forever now. Like, now I don't feel like I don't have any fuel in the tank. I just feel like me. I'm trying. Yeah. Like, I've slowly stopped thinking about work as work, and more about it just being part of my life. And I've stopped feeling like this is all taxing, because it's like, well, life's you know, this is just par for the course. Life's taxing. It doesn't matter what we'd be doing. Yeah, it takes up energy. So I've tried to disconnect this idea that I've got this fuel tank and it's running lower and lower the more I work. And at the same time, I'm trying to give myself more and more breaks. Like, I try to exercise as much as I can. I'm going to be, soon enough, once the dust is settling, making sure that I don't stay in the office too late, because it can do nutty things to your mind if you just keep hammering at it too hard. And I think the team here is really good at striking that balance between working very hard when we need to, but also not going, you know, above and beyond. Because I've seen devs who have, like, you know, bags under their eyes that go all the way down. It's just, they look a mess.
Yeah.
Because they hammer it too hard, and it's like, you've got to give yourself a break. You've got to let your mind disconnect and see things from a different perspective. Like, doing the open world stuff, that came about because I had a small holiday to Scotland. I went completely, you know, away from all this, just disconnected for a few days, and that idea just popped in there. And I'm pretty confident I'd have never have had that thought had I just been in the box, you know, in here at this PC, just focused. I don't think I'd have ever had that thought, because I'm too enclosed. And so I think it's really important for everyone here and any other game dev to strike up a balance. Yeah, maybe you're not going to go on a 5-week holiday, but take breaks wherever you can, space things out.
Yeah. Well, I realized that that I had been I locked myself in a room for 2 years, and I was becoming just a miserable, angry person who just wasn't getting inspired anymore. And that's one of the reasons why I decided on, okay, like, my wife wanted to go to Europe, and I was like, all right, let's do it. Like, let's just do it, because it's not like I'm not going to get inspiration from that. You know what I mean? Taking that much time off and living for a little bit, it's good. How would you, or maybe you could give advice to anyone who's starting out in the games industry, because I know personally it's really easy to just think the harder you work, the better your product will be, without taking any, like, mental health breaks, you know, or you know, exercising or eating right, things like that. How important is that stuff?
I think it's so important that if you're going to say something like, I've got to do 12 hours of work a day or 10 hours, whatever, then part of that has to include, like, factor in exercising as work. Consider it part of that if you're going to go down that route. Like, because you have to. You've got to consider getting away from this thing beaming light into your face. You've got to consider time for that. You've got to consider getting your bloodstream flowing and getting up off your chair. And it's I don't practice what I preach nearly enough. It's a really easy trap to fall into, that you've got to work more and that equals results. And it doesn't. Sometimes it does. Sometimes there is crunch where you've just got to sit there and do the job. And there are other times where it doesn't help you one bit. And especially if you do this month and month onwards and onwards with no real break. Yeah, you burn out, you become disenfranchised with everything. You completely lose perspective. Like, if as good as the team is here, I've found that occasionally speaking to other developers and just getting an outside perspective can really help me see things from a different perspective. Like, if you're not talking to others, you're going to end up in a sort of echo chamber. And as soon as negativity starts bouncing around in the echo chamber, that grows and multiplies and becomes more of a problem. So yeah, like, you've got to get out there, you've got to have a social life, you've got to get out and do things that you enjoy that aren't work-related. For me, it's rock climbing. I really love rock climbing, so I try to do that as much as possible. Again, admittedly not enough as I should. I'm not following my own advice, but you'll fall apart at the seams if you just sit at your desk and just work. That's a fact.
Yeah.
And I really take umbrage. I get very annoyed with all of these articles from the tech world and startups and stuff. You know, was it Marissa from Yahoo was putting up this thing where she was like, I do 15 hours a day every day. And it's like, well, no, you don't. You don't do 15 hours a day. Like, you don't. Stop lying. Everyone's lying about this stuff. They don't do that much because you spend 2 hours at the ping pong table. Yeah. You might. Yeah. It's bull. And it's just such a damaging, negative thing to say. Fair enough. Sometimes you work 15 hours every day for a week straight, and then you go to work the next week. And again, sometimes that happens, and you've got to. But acting like that should be the standard, and that's the only way to generate results. It's a lot of crap, and it's just, I don't know why everyone seems to fall into it. Like, everyone seems to be susceptible, especially when you're in charge. Like, you feel like you've got to be there at all times. Mm. You almost feel bad for not, even if you're not doing anything, you just feel bad for not sitting at your desk. It's a weird sensation. And if you don't become aware of what you're doing, if you don't take a step back and go, actually, this is actually really unhealthy for me and will be really unhealthy for the team if I keep doing it. You fall into a severe rut. It's really bad. So you've got to stop that.
It's like, unless you're in, like, a rule that I have for myself is unless I'm in crunch mode, I've got to try and, like, actively in my mind make sure that I'm enjoying my life. Like, so I'm coming home, I'm going to see a movie with the missus, I'm going to the beach, I'm going to the gym, I'm doing something that's not game development, because otherwise I won't be around long enough. Like, I'll end up in the loony bin because I'll just break down. You need to have those moments, or you'll release a game that's just not good, or you won't release a game because of the stress or whatever. So I think that's very important, like you said. Is there any advice that you would give? I noticed in one of your in I watched the video that you released called A Message from Andrew. And it really spoke to me. I've been in that. You spoke about, just doing the 9-to-5 and a job and it being a very torturous environment and not pursuing your dreams, I suppose. What advice would you give to someone who, you know, is at that stage in life where they can't necessarily jump into their dream, but they know it's around the corner? How would you say someone to take that, like, what advice would you say to take that step, like that, those first steps?
I'd say kind of like us, it's taking small steps. So, you know, if your dream is to make games but you don't have any skills and you do a 9-to-5, well, unfortunately you're probably doing that 9-to-5 for quite a bit longer, unless you can rustle up the money for going into education and get a loan. But even then, it's like that, like I said at the start of all this, like, I don't recommend that to most people because, you know, it creates this new financial burden for you, and you're in an environment that you're spending a lot for that you're probably not going to get much out of. And plus, all these tools, all these resources are free, and unless you live really out in the sticks, you're probably near a dev group. You'll be near a community that will meet up and make games and collaborate. And if you're not, when we were doing the Left 4 Dead modding, we had a team of 12 across the entire world. We had people in Australia, Hong Kong, Canada, Britain, Germany. Yeah, it wasn't easy because we had to stay up a lot to like this. You have to be up late or up early speaking with people. But it's all doable. You've just got to find the time and sacrifice, yeah, some of your time to make those dreams come true. So I would recommend small steps. I've had a lot of devs from that video especially come to me and say, oh, I've got this massive fighting game or this exploration game or this RPG that I want to make, but I've been working on it for 2 years and it's nowhere near done. And every one of them I say, like, well, take that core concept and see if you can make something that could be executed in a month. Like, put out a mobile game, put out something on Newgrounds or Miniclip for free. Just do anything that shows that you can put a product together and ship it. And then next, of course, figure out how you're going to do this full time. How are you actually going to generate money from it? You know, if you have the skills to do lots of small Flash type games, not Flash anymore, I guess it's HTML5 is what people are using. But if you have the ability to do that, get a load of those out, generate some ad revenue.
Yeah.
Or put a product out there that's small, show that you've made some money, go to an investor. Team up with a mod group, try to put something... I mean, look at something like Squad. Squad was born out of this gigantic modding effort for, I think it was Armor. I feel bad not knowing these details. I believe it was an Armor mod. But anyway, they took a modding concept, showed that it worked. They've gone on early access, they did Kickstarter, they made a load of money. And now they've got a load of support, and their dreams are coming true. So it's just about being, as we say, being smart, working smart. Not just saying, all right, if I sit here for 12 hours a day, or if I do a 9-to-5 and then do, you know, 5-till-2, working on my own projects. It's like, that's not going to do it. You've got to really think, how am I going to sustain myself and generate cash to be able to make these things, and then sell those things successfully to make more money to keep going. I think this is why like 5-10% of us make it through, because there's no right answer. You're probably just going to have life punch you in the face repeatedly. There's a lot of luck involved. And, if you're not at the right place at the right time, you might do everything right and still fail. I mean, there's several things I really feel that we've done extremely right, and we've not really seen the returns we'd have expected on them. And it's just one of these things. Mm. And that's where you've got to keep persevering and keep grafting. But if you don't have the money to do that, you can't. Like, if we run out of money here, the lights turn off, the computers shut down, and it doesn't matter if we sit at our desks, nothing gets done. So, I feel bad because I don't really have a very good answer for this, but it really is a case of, like, if you're wanting to do this indie from the get-go, start small. And if you want to do indie, but with more security... I mean, again, guys like Shovel Knight, the Shovel Knight devs, I think they're called Wave... Is it? No, it's not Wave Forward, it's Full Sail or something. They were ex... it's dropped out of my head. They were ex-Double Fine devs, I believe. Or another... It was Double Fine or one of the others. But they were ex, so they'd had experience and clearly had made contacts and everything. You know, people look at Shovel Knight and go, how did this really weird retro game come out of nowhere... how's it so good? It's like, well, it's good because it's made by guys who had a lot of experience in a high-pressure environment, and they'll have also had the contacts and the name, you know, X-whatever devs make cool retro game. You know, it's no mistake that it went the way that it did. They were clearly very calculating in each one of their steps, from leaving that job, setting up a company, making a game that took all the best elements of retro, but left behind all of the worst elements, and used whatever contacts they had up until that point to heavily promote the game, despite clearly not having a huge budget. You know, they have a full breakdown as well of like sales and what they did to get to that point and how much they grafted, where they were working for basically nothing. They didn't pay themselves for months. And it's like, that's an extreme amount of hard work, really smart work, built on years of work making games for other people at other companies. It's not easy, like, especially in 2016, if you want to start developing, if you want to be a solo indie dev, odds are really stacked against you. I don't really know how you're going to do it, but there's a way. I'm sure there is.
Yeah, definitely. So is there any other advice, before we finish up, is there any other advice that you give to indie game developers, people starting out, maybe people who haven't released a game yet, a big game?
I think we've covered a lot of bases. I mean, I guess I've always found that working with people is the best way to go. Like, try to deliberate tasks. If you're not good at something, You don't have, you know, if you're an artist or a designer, and that's what you do, you don't have to become amazing at programming to make your thing. Like, try find other people to work with. Like, I'm a manager at heart. I like to design things, but because of the role that I have in this company, I mostly just tell other people what to do, and they do it. And I'm fine with that. A lot of people seem to have a problem with that and think, oh, I'm just an ideas guy. It's like, well, no, you're not, because you're the thing holding everything together. And I've always found that whether or not you want to have a leadership position or not, trying to do absolutely everything yourself is probably a bad idea. And even if you are doing everything yourself, talk to people. Talk to other people in your field. You know, if you're getting into programming, just ask for help. You'd be amazed how much people will do for others completely for free. And especially people like myself who have been through the process and have had a gigantic amount of not just help, but just free work has been done for us. It makes me incredibly grateful for getting to this point, to all those people who helped us. And it makes me want to help others. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know? And I think that most people in our position are the same. If you send them a message or a tweet or email, they'll probably get back to you and give you some kind of a pointer or advice. So try find other people you can work with. Always ask for help. And just stick at it, basically.
Awesome. One last thing. What are some games that you're excited about in your personal life?
Oh, that's difficult because I've completely... completely forgotten that other games exist, just focusing on Unbox. That's a tough one. If I have to be careful, I was really into Red Orchestra 2, like unnaturally into it, and Rising Storm looks really good, so I really like the look of that. Obviously, Ukulele, played Toy Box a load, really love the look of Ukulele. One of my friends is developing a game called Mainlining, which is where you play as a sort of like... I guess it's like Papers, Please, but you're hacking, and you've got to like hack into people, and you put out a demo. So that I'm really looking forward to. Beyond that, I don't know, I need to kind of get back into the gaming sphere and start playing stuff more. I mean, there's been a ton of stuff that's come out over the past 21 months as well that I missed, that I did want to play. So I've got a growing backlog of titles to get through.
It's hard, hey, because when you start getting into game development, a lot of your time just goes towards that. Like, it's very similar in a way. Gaming and game making, I find it's like sometimes it's like problem solving and being creative, and a lot of scratches a lot of the same itch. All right, well, I just want to say thanks for coming on the podcast. It's been a pleasure to hear a bit about the games industry and what you guys have gone through. If anyone, I'll leave a link for the game Unbox in the description. Hopefully people can check it out and play it. It's a really, really fun game. And yeah, thanks heaps for joining me. And thanks, man. Thanks, Andrew.
No, thank you. Thank you as well for having me as well. I hope you get over your cold as quickly as I hope I get over mine.
Yeah, it's
over. And hopefully we can catch up again down the line. I'll have maybe some more words of wisdom for everybody.
Cool. Thanks. Thank you for listening to the Let's Make a Game Together podcast. That was Andrew Bennison from Prospect Games in the UK. My name is Dave, and thank you for watching. If you're interested in getting into the games industry and don't know where to start, a good place I may suggest is to start making, exactly like Andrew said, start making your own games. And if you don't know where to start, follow my tutorial on how to create a infinite runner in 3 hours. That's like, we do absolutely everything in 3 hours. Link is in the description down below. Make sure you go follow Prospect Games on Twitter or Andrew on Twitter. Tell him I said hi. And also check out Unbox on Steam. It's available now, and it's a really, really awesome game. So I would definitely recommend checking it out if you've enjoyed anything that you've seen today. Thanks for watching, guys. And as always, keep on game making. Peace.